Joining us now, we welcome Maria Konnikova to the program today. Really an interesting book she's written. We've all been through different times, I guess we've been taken, and that's the topic of the book. It's called The Confidence Game, Why We Fall For It Every Time. And Maria Konnikova joins us from, I believe, New York today. Maria, how are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
You're in New York City, right?
I am.
How are things? Did they dig it out yet up there? I'm from there originally.
They did. They did dig it out.
That was a tough one to go through.
It absolutely was. I had several flights canceled as a result.
Well, it's an interesting book. Like I said, I grew up in New York, and you talk about it in the book. I remember walking up and down the city occasionally. You'd see these three-card Monte games. I guess that's the first time I was kind of exposed to the confidence game. I never played it, but, you know, kind of watched it in interest. And that's really the topic of the book, right? People still fall for these things.
Absolutely. The funny thing about three-card Monte is even people who know exactly what it is, who know it's a scam, will often fall for it because three-card Monte is not just played by the person who is out there with the three cards who's screaming, you know, follow the lady, and if you can guess which one the queen is, then you double your cash. But it's a Monte gang, so there are all these players that are involved. So there's always a shill that's winning. And so you think, oh, look, somebody can win. Then there's also someone who often will whisper in your ear and say, hey, you see that card? It's marked. If you just know the marked card, then you're going to win. And so people who know exactly what Monte is will often still fall for that drama and that dramatic sweep because they think that they can beat the Monte operator. They say, I know it's a scam, but I am a little bit smarter than this con artist. And so they fall for it. And that sense of overconfidence is something that I think unites all types of cons, from something like three-card Monte to much more elaborate long cons that play out over weeks, months, sometimes even years.
It's amazing. There's also usually some pickpockets around, too, those games.
Oh, absolutely.
But yeah, when you think of it, I guess that's the bottom line, right? The person thinks, well, I won't be the one that gets taken, and those are often the people that get taken the worst.
Absolutely. I think that the less you think you're likely to be a victim, the more enticing of a target you are for the con artist, both because they just want to take you down a notch, but also because you become less likely to see the signs because you are so incredibly sure of your ability to spot them. And all of us have this to a certain extent. I mean, most of us think that we'd be able to spot if someone is lying to us. The truth is we can't. You know, we're basically no better at chance at spotting lying, and yet the misperception persists. And so people will often fall for con artists because they'll think, oh, I would have recognized it if it were untrue. But because I didn't recognize it, it means it's true, which obviously is not true.
Well, what's amazing to me now with the advent of the internet, and again, you talk about that in the book, is these email scams. Yes, the Nigerian email scam, that's the most famous one. I guess people are still falling for it because I keep getting those things every day, at least some variation of it. Is that the same thing? People think I'm going to be the one that actually gets the $1 million sent to me?
Yeah, because a lot of times it's no longer the Nigerian prince. They can actually wrap this up in a lot of different paper, put a lot of different bows on it, make it look very different. So the Nigerian scam itself is the Spanish prisoner, which is one of the oldest cons in history, at least in written history, that we know of, which is, you know, there's a prisoner, he's a Spanish prisoner, he's incredibly wealthy, he's a nobleman, and if you pay his bail, or if you help him get out of jail, that he'll share, in it, because he's so incredibly grateful, he'll share his fortune with you. And if you realize that's the exact same plot line that you get in these Nigerian scams, and people will say, oh, it's a Nigerian scam, I'm not going to fall for it. Yeah, but now let's dress it up differently. Let's have it, you know, if you just give a little bit of money for this, then suddenly you'll get a lot. And a lot of people will end up, and I won't say a lot, but some people will certainly end up falling for this because they won't recognize it. It's not like it's sitting in your inbox and says, hi, I'm the Nigerian fraud, here I am.
I'm getting ones now where they attach to a person you know in your email somehow and say, I'm stranded in an airport or stranded somewhere, please send me money to help me get home. I mean, that's one of the newer
ones. Absolutely. Yes, that happens all the time. And that happens on email. That happens over social media. It happens on the phone. So it's a variation of a theme that someone you know is in trouble. And so you because it's someone you know and care about, and they're in trouble, of course you want to help. And that's what con artists do right away. They engage your emotion, because when we're thinking emotionally, we are not thinking rationally. So imagine if you're a grandparent and you get a phone call that says, you know, oh my God, your granddaughter, she just had a horrible car accident. We need to transport her. We need to airlift her to a hospital, but we need money. Can you wire money right away? You know, I got your contact information from her cell phone. Of course you're going to start panicking, oh my God, my beloved granddaughter is in a car crash. So you're so emotional that you don't actually think rationally. That's the grandparent scam, by the way, which is, again, a variation on a theme. And these sorts of things play out all the time because con artists are so good at telling us the story that's going to engage our emotion.
Yeah, you mentioned the grandparent scam, not to sound ageist or anything, but are older people more susceptible, or a lot of young people fall for these too?
Young people fall for these too. It's a common misperception that the elderly are more susceptible because we often think of the elderly as vulnerable. We think, oh, well, you know, that person, that's not me. You know, I'm not elderly. I'd know better. But the truth is that different kinds of scams have different kinds of targets. And so, for instance, investment scams, the people who are more likely to fall for those are people who are very intelligent, well-educated, good investors, people who are often active and have an active portfolio in the stock market. So people who really, you know, this is their sweet spot, and yet they fall for an investment scam, whereas the grandparent scam obviously targets grandparents. You'll still see those types of things. I know someone who's middle-aged, even a little bit younger than middle-aged, who fell for something like this, who ended up wiring money to a friend who was stranded in London because, you know, it's your friend and the friend is emailing you. And younger people trust technology much more because we've grown up with it. And to us, it's not anything weird or scary. So in that sense, we're less suspicious sometimes when we're approached on a technological forum.
I always figured if they're really in trouble, why don't they call me directly? They wouldn't email me, so.
Exactly. But what if their phone's stolen?
I guess so. But I figure unless I hear their voice, I'm not sending you any money. But, yeah, you talk about the Madoff. That was one of the huge, obviously, financial scandals. And a lot of the people that invested with him knew him. So that's a tough one right there. I mean,
absolutely.
These were intelligent people that invested with him.
Yeah, and that's very common. When it's someone you know, someone who's a member of your community, it's kind of a badge of approval already. It's a badge of trust. And so you see a lot of con artists who kind of infiltrate communities. So religious communities are often used. So in the case of Bernie Madoff, it was the Jewish community. I write about a guy who used the Episcopalian Church in that community because you already, you know, once you're part of that community, you might even be a new member of the congregation, but by sheer virtue of being a member of that congregation, you have this aura of trust and familiarity that makes people more likely to trust you with all sorts of things, including their cash, including their, you know, their respect, sometimes their love. I mean, this is how sweetheart scams often operate as well.
I know you talk about in the book how to spot a con game. I guess the old adage, if it's too good to be true, it is, right? Isn't that number one thing to do?
Yep. That is the number one thing to do. Unfortunately, it's much easier said than done. It's really easy for me to write that. But we never think something is too good to be true when it's happening to us.
Mm-hmm.
We only ask questions when something's bad. When something's wonderful, we say, oh, at last, you know, I really deserve this. This is great. So it's really hard for us to spot it as too good to be true. Because nothing's too good for us, right?
That's right. That's what we deserve it, right?
Absolutely.
And that's the mindset that con artists want you to have. You know? you deserve it, and you put your defenses down.
Mm-hmm. That's absolutely right.
Well, it's a fascinating book called The Confidence Game, Why We Fall For It Every Time. We've been talking with Maria Konnikova today, just kind of touching on a few topics in it, but we highly recommend it here at our show. And Maria, do you have a website people can get more information or get the book?
Sure, it's just www.mariakonnikova.com. One word.
Konnikova. That's how you spell the last name.
And absolutely right.
Maria, appreciate you taking the time today. Try and stay warm in New York, and hopefully we can talk to you again. Thanks for joining us.
Likewise. Thank you so much for having me.
I'm Stan Brock. 30 years ago, I formed Remote Area Medical to help people overseas. But then we found generations of families in America, isolated by poverty from the health care they need. Together, we can take dental, vision, and medical help to 1 million adults and their kids, right here at home in the United States of America.
If you'd like to order the book we're talking about, please go to DougMilesMedia.com and enter the author's name in the Amazon search box. Thank you for listening. Please come back soon for more conversations here at DougMilesMedia.com. This has been a presentation of Doug Miles Media, all rights reserved. You can listen to or download previous programs at iTunes, Stitcher.com, or DougMilesMedia.com.